Well, moving on now, we're going to start with the conference, which will be having a very robust panel discussion. The topic is building brand loyalty with the millennials. Well, they are born in the world of emerging technology, surfing the internet, navigating through ads, filtering huge amounts of digital content, and these all things are not at all a problem for them, and they do not consider this as a waste of time at all. So the panel will be discussing the various aspects on how these brands can build loyalty among the millennials by different approaches. Well, I would like to call on stage, first of all, our session chair, an experienced business leader with a demonstrated history of working in the broadcast media industry, skilled in business strategy and execution, leading cross-functional and multi-location teams, managing high-performance team. Well, please put your hands together as I welcome the session chair, Mr. Ashwin Padmanabhan, Head Trading and Partnerships, Group M. Welcome, sir. Moving forward, I would like to invite our panelists over here. I would like to invite Mr. Ankit Paul, Country Lead Monetization, Strategy and Programmatic, Alibaba UC. Come on, everyone. Mr. Karan Shroff, Head Brand Marketing, Xiaomi. Well, I hope I've pronounced it correctly. Mr. Naresh Krishnaswamy, Head Growth and Marketing, Cure.fit. Rahul Deora, VP Marketing, Urban Clap. And Ms. Somasree Bose, Head Marketing, Godrej Consumer Product. Well, joining the panel, we also have Mr. Bharat Rajamani, the Partner Advisory Services, KPMG India. Welcome to all the panelists and our session chair. The panel is all yours.
Thank you so much. So we'll get into it right away without, because introductions are done. You know, this is a conversation we've all been having every day. It's not something which probably for the first time any of us are going to have. Within our own offices and outside, this is a challenge that we're all facing. So we'll spend the next 40 minutes trying to understand from an experienced group of marketers here how they deal with this challenge of connecting with the millennial audience and the consumer every day. What are their own strategies? And what's interesting of this group, and I'm sure you would have noticed, is everybody here comes from a very different industry. But they're all talking to the same consumer. What would be interesting to understand is how different products and services coming from completely opposite ends of the spectrum, how do they connect with the consumer and how do they manage their day-to-day interactions? And you know, I'm going to throw this first to a very interesting, a brand, and my personal favorite, a very young brand, and this is something which I'm really proud of what you have built at Urban Clap. 20,000 odd, independent service providers who are mini entrepreneurs. How do you manage to build that consistency and that engagement when you need to, bring out the brand promise through people whom you don't even control directly?
Thanks, Ashwin. So I think to answer that question, I'll take 60 seconds to zoom out a little bit and maybe set the context of how the offline world works for services. So consider a typical beautician. She works out of a parlor, makes close to 14 to 18,000 rupees in a month, works from 9 to 5, serves anywhere from 8 to 10 clients a day. Whatever she makes, 80% of it is pocketed by the parlor owner. And the growth trajectory that she has is not looking very, very good right now. Now cut to when she comes on board with a platform like Urban Clap, suddenly her avenues for growth multiply because now she's a master of her own destiny. She is serving 4 to 5 clients a day at her own time, and pocketing 80% of the earnings overall, minimum. So now what impact does this have on her? Let's think about it. Suddenly her income has doubled. So she is now the largest breadwinner in her family. Her kids can start going to better schools. she maybe moves into a better house, she maybe buys a car. So to answer your question, Ashwin, there are three things that are needed to manage something like this, right? First is creating the right business model, right, in which everyone wins, including the customer, the service professional, as well as the company. Second is ensuring that we give them all the tools to succeed, right, from market knowledge to a lot of training that standardizes the service. And third, of course, is the intent, because a service professional sticks to UrbanClap, yes, for monetary reasons, but the most important reason that comes out in our conversations is the respect they get from the society when they sort of tell them that they are working with UrbanClap.
So are you saying that the experience that your consumer gets is in a way starts internally when you're able to inspire and to motivate so many professionals to, because you're giving them the chance to grow, you're giving them the chance to do something with their lives, they're motivated, they're inspired, and thus, to a great extent, the service quality and delivery gets taken care of? Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely, absolutely. I think you got right on point.
Cool. Now, similar kind of business for you, Naresh. Not similar, it's more in control for you, but heavily on the services front, right from food delivery to food that you yourself make and deliver to your fitness centers. Very diverse range of services and products.
Yep.
And how do you manage the customers' expectations and how do you talk to them?
Yeah, so I think on the first part, which sort of Rahul mentioned, which just starts with kind of what value you are offering to the partner. So in our case, like you correctly pointed out, everything is in-house. Like all people touching the customer are on our roll. So it really starts with the culture of the company and what the founders really emphasize from day one, what kind of behavior leaders show on a daily basis. And having that loop where you're talking to the customer almost real time. So it's all good to do social media sentiments over a month and comment about how it's trended. But on a daily basis in businesses like ours, fires happen, like things go wrong, customers have experiences that are not desired. Both on the positive front, they have great experiences as well as bad experiences. So the culture of the organization in an industry like this where you're touching the customer almost on a daily basis is what sets the context of what kind of experience you give to the customer. Because it just, in a company of our size, which is still only 3 years old, the connection between the endpoint to the top is not very large. I mean, information does flow very fast, given the nature of our size and how everybody is anyway connected through email and the mobile phone. So just stressing on what kind of culture the founders set, then what kind of behavior the leaders underneath show on a daily basis, what kind of behavior you reward, and create that obsession around customer experience on a daily basis. And this can only happen when you can measure it almost real time. So our North Star has always been this metric called ratings, which is a measure from the customer on every interaction that they've had, whether it's a fitness class or whether it's a food delivery. And how importantly you treat that metric, how importantly you treat positive initiatives that kind of drive that metric up is what sets the tone in a completely single-owned sort of first-party business like ours.
What's interesting is that in both the examples that we've discussed, it's about the experience that we're talking about, we give the consumer. But how are we driving our communication with the consumer?
Yeah.
Not necessarily through the experience, but also independent of the experience, there's a lot of communication that we are, and engagement that we are driving. Does this feedback loop also go back into your communication in some form?
Absolutely. So I think when you're in such a high-touch industry, you understand what the consumer is. You may have a certain desire to build a certain brand, and you may think the category is like this, so therefore the communication needs to be like this. But when you have that feedback loop, you get that information real time from a consumer on what they're thinking of your brand, what moves the experience in a positive and negative way. So that definitely feeds us back. So I'll give you a simple example. The gym industry has always been about showing extremely aspirational imagery, unattainable kind of imagery of people with really grotesque muscles or 0% fat, etc. Right, and that's been the norm for years, I would say like 30, 40 years. But you know, what we observe from our consumers, you walk into a cult center on a daily basis, you will not see one individual that looks like that. And you will also realize that fit people don't need to look like that. So when your customers tell you again, like when what positive impact fitness has had on their life, on their journey, on their relationships, etc. As a marketeer, you then realize that these are the things that you want to blow up in your communication. Now, there will always be a delta between what kind of imagery drives CTRs, drives performance, versus what is really the ground experience. It's always somewhere in the middle. Marketeers do want to play on aspiration, but you know where the line is. Basis what your consumers are telling you on a basis, a daily basis, what's driving delight for them. So for us, at least, the brand and the customer experience is a very sort of, it's a continuum.
It's a continuous.
We do not look at it as separate entities that are trying to, you know, talk to the customer in different languages. So the same team talks to social media pretty
cool.
much.
Cool.
The people who are resolving queries versus people who are doing marketing. The same people, you know, are on Twitter, responding to customer queries as well as trying to market on Twitter. So we try to keep that continuum so that who we are versus what we deliver, there isn't a gap that customers ever perceive.
That's an interesting, you know, the way you've organized it, that you've brought these two together.
Yeah.
And yeah, as we evolved in organizations, we have tended to keep these two separate.
Yeah.
But quite interesting that you brought them together. Karan, you've as Xiaomi, you've always looked at what is being spoken about in the air, and you've built campaigns around that. So you always capitalized on conversations and then built, you know, your campaigns around that, the brand promise around that. Is that the DNA of the brand? Is that something which you do every time? And how do you do it every time?
So one of our core philosophies has always been, you know, from the day we entered the Indian market, incidentally, we've just finished 5 years now, has always been to listen to the consumer. You know, we always want to know what they are thinking, what they want, what direction they want the brand to move in. To the degree, our products are also sometimes designed, the UI is designed around what the consumer wants. There are features added basis what the consumer wants. So typically, we are always listening to them. That's been one of our core philosophies. It's been in our DNA through and through. It's something we've carried from day one, right all the way through till our launches, even to the one that happened yesterday.
What will be interesting is if you take us through how did the Naya Note campaign get created, because clearly it is contextual.
Yeah.
Right? It was a new product as well as it was in the air.
So all our campaigns have been Mi Fan centric. You know, our community in India, Mi Fan community in India, right now on the Mi community app, we have about 15 million monthly active users. So we realized that this audience that we are talking to is very glued on to the brand. They're following us very closely. They have a lot of expectations. And we figured that we need to build campaigns that resonate with them, not telling them stories that they don't want to hear, but telling them stories that they want to hear. So the Naya Note campaign was sort of developed on that. There was this whole demonetization, topic that had triggered that point, in India. And we kind of figured that the new Redmi Note series that gets launched every year had a similar excitement. So maybe a few weeks before the launch, there is that buzz, oh, there's a new Note coming, there's a new Note coming. Have you heard about it? You know, what does it have? So we took the whole demonetization angle. We took our Naya Note, which is the new Redmi Note 5 Pro at that point, and we built a campaign around that. It did really well. The Mi fans loved it. Another similar campaign was Kiska Baja. You know, I used to travel a lot. I still travel a lot. And, you know, even in fact, maybe 15 minutes back, I heard the Mi ringtone go off somewhere. And, you know, the typical thing, it's not been something that's probably in your role, but been something that's been happening for years, is when a phone goes off, you say, Kiska Baja. What we kind of realized was people buy our phones, but they don't change the ringtone for some reason. Maybe they love it a lot. And there's that one common ringtone that's playing everywhere. And the communication that we wanted to roll out was we were the number one smartphone brand with about 30% market share. So we, one out of three phones is a Xiaomi phone, typically. So that ringtone's everywhere. So we built an ad campaign around that. And what was interesting is the next day, Twitter took to it, and everybody said, you know, the ad played on TV, and I thought my phone was ringing in the room. So our focus has always been consumer-centric, whether it's marketing, whether it's product, whether it's anything to do with even feedback. We're always listening to them and we react to them.
So what I'm hearing consistently is that the millennial consumer obviously is very expressive, talks about what he or she wants. And whenever you, as brands, as you're evolving and you're building successful brands, you're not just listening, but you're almost co-creating. Can we say that?
Yeah, they're a part of a journey. You know, it's very important to have them. I mean, if you look back maybe 10 years ago, if you had a complaint or a grievance against a brand, you would look behind the box and then write to them. Today you have social media, they can reach you immediately. So we need to be on our toes, respond to them, understand them, you know, listen to them more importantly, and from there build a brand. So it is co-creating.
And I'm going to jump to you, Somashree, because a traditional product category, personal and home care. And I'm interested to know how things have changed for you in terms of the way you engage with consumer, how they engage with you, and how does it change the way you communicate the brand to them, whether it's in advertising or in any form, right from the pack shot to the advertising. What's changed for you?
So before getting into the industry that I'm in, I would just take a step back to maybe spend a few seconds on telling you the, or rather understanding or sort of sharing with all our understanding of this millennial, right? I would say it's a digital know-it-all generation. And when I say know-it-all, essentially, they make it their business that they actually get to know it all. So even before all the brands start talking about, you know, let's say I talk about soap, they will possibly know about all the ingredients and functionality, etc., already by searching it online. Because this generation is also about, you know, very, very inquisitive nature. So they search it all. So the way we changed our communication, for example, I'm handling Synthol. And 2012, we actually relaunched our brand. Before that, we were all about freshness. But freshness in the space of bathing inside the traditional toilet, bathroom, etc. In 2012, what we realized was that these millennials, if you want to keep talking to them, you can't just be selling a product. You have to make them live an experience. And one of the best examples that I really hold close to myself is what I have read. And maybe if somebody over here belongs to that industry over here, can talk about is most of the destinations for holidays are decided now basis the experience created on Instagram, right? Maybe if somebody from the travel industry over here can vet it out, but the understanding is that it's the Instagram of the world which is actually driving a lot of experience. So what we did for Synthol was, instead of making it a freshening device just in your bathroom, we actually made bathing itself an experience and have exaggerated the whole bathing experience by taking outdoors, taking it to, you know, absolute exotic locales, making it an experience, and then seeping in the brand functionality into it. Because, of course, that's the reason why you exist. You cannot do without the functionality. So creating that experience is important because millennial is all about living that experience rather than buying that product. Second thing is, because we are not just in the service industry, we are offline as well, creating that kind of experience offline is super important and ensuring that that experience happens when they want that experience. And not just bombarding every time with your message, like a lot of time it happens for us when you're searching the Facebook and suddenly some message pops in you are not even interested in. For example, Godrej Air. We actually launched that air care brand by fragrancing newspapers. One is, at the cheapest cost, I got lakhs of people experience, actually millions of people in a single day experience the newspaper, and that happened first thing in the morning. The insight over there was, people love waking up to a nice cup of coffee or tea, and that fragrance of tea, coffee, etc., that is really freshening, that literally wakes you up, apart from the daily ritual of reading the newspaper. What better than getting you there and surprising you with a great aroma? So just few examples where we drove the experience across our brands.
I'm sure a couple of my friends from the print industry will be extremely happy with what you've done. And there are many of them here. So we expect you to do more of that.
Thank you so much, and we would love to discuss.
In a world dominated by the digital gang here.
Yes, we would love to have that discussion offline.
So what I'm kind of hearing you say is that the expectation of the consumer now is satisfy me now, right? If, when I want to, I would want it now. What you also said was that I research, I would ask around, I would talk to friends and family and influenced in a way,
yes.
Right? Whether it's by my own circle of cohorts or by somebody else whom I look up to. Doesn't need to be a legend to look up to anymore. It could be Saifu that I can look up to, right? So that seems to play an important role. The cohorts with whom I link up with and I look up to in terms of my decision making. And you know, I want to talk to you because these are all coming through UC, right? There's a huge millions and millions of people are searching for content and accessing content through UC. What are the trends that you're seeing? Where do they access it from? How do they access? What kind of content? It'll be very interesting for us to know what you have observed as UC browser.
Well, so in regards with UC, yes, there's a lot of data which we collect in regards with, you know, making the unique personas of the user, understanding their behavior, what exactly they are doing on their mobile phone or on the UC browser when they come on it. We have done it differently now. In the last 1 year, we have changed a lot, and we have started analyzing as to the kind of behavior user is doing, not only on UC, but on the other apps which he's using on the mobile phones. Right now, we are sitting at approximately 140 million monthly active users, what we generally you know, claim in the market, and that's what we are getting. Now, from where we are getting those users is very important. We are getting these users from the perspective of them having to, you know, get all the information at one place. We are not letting the user go out of UC to any other place in regards with, if I need to, you know, elaborate on that. We are working with some of the biggest, you know, advertising companies in the space, the biggest of clients in the space. Every time you come to UC, you can do everything inside it. You don't have to go to a third party or a third app or, you know, a third site to do things. When a user is able to do everything inside UC, I, as a person who is actually managing it, is able to read through the mind of the user. I'm able to define the unique personas of that user by analyzing what are they using inside the UC browser. What we have done recently is, earlier there was UC News, as everyone knows. We have actually integrated UC News in the browser. So when you go on the UC browser to navigate, as soon as you scroll down, you have the UC News feed starts coming in. So you have plethora of information, entertainment, politics, news, everyone at one place. You don't have to go anywhere outside.
Ankit is not wanting to give the trade secret of what is the consumer doing and who is the consumer.
Well, so that's pretty confidential. I just can't get into that.
You're very, very neatly moved away from what I wanted you to talk about.
But yes, I would say one thing. So right now, I was actually reading a report, the Kantar report, the latest one. So India right now sits at approximately 450 million millennials. And out of which, 300 million are in tier 2, tier 3, and tier 4 market. And we are pretty big on that. Rather very big on that.
Gave a little bit. Bharat, you obviously talk to everybody across the media and the customer, you know, brand side, right from people who run brands to people who run the companies themselves. What's the general talk that you get to hear when people talk about connecting with this consumer? Is there a clear thought that you see emerging? Are there strategies that seem to be, you know, kind of a common kind of a playbook? Is that something which you seem to be, you know, noticing that's happening across organizations?
In India, if you drive 200 kilometers, you know, you get to interact with people who talk different languages, and you know, you talk about people who consume different kind of media, right? So the era of millennials, it was always there. But the current millennials, you know, the challenge is all the digital aspects here, right? So everybody is investing on digital, everybody is investing on analytics, and understanding the media consumption habits of all these millennials people. So that's the whole ask from the audience.
But good to hear that everybody's investing in it. But how am I expecting to kind of deploy this investment to connect with my consumers? And how am I expecting that this investment is going to really help me build a stronger brand? Is there a thought on that?
See, as Anurag said, ROI is a big, it's a challenge. So how are we measuring the return on marketing investments is another aspect which we are all looking into. Analyzing your last 24 months media data and predicting your next 12 months is a question. So that is what the brands are looking for now. Deep dive into your last 12 months and 24 months data and understand this and predict your next 12 months.
So given the fact that we all kind of agree that we're listening to consumer on a real-time basis, we are trying to co-create our communication with them, we also accept that because it's a connected world, it's real-time, not all experiences are great. What I would like to hear is, for example, how does Xiaomi manage a negative communication? And how do you kind of spin it? Or how do you kind of address it? Spin is not the right word, but probably how do you address it? And how do you then probably use it to build on your own communication? Because that's something which we all are facing every day, right? That's the new aspect of communication today. So how do you manage the worst case scenario?
Well, the easiest way that we know at Xiaomi is to always be honest. So if there is a flaw or a mistake from our end, we just own it. We just say, yes, this was wrong. We are fixing it. It'll be fixed by this and this date, right? And if there are expectations that are out there that aren't being met for any reason, and there are these times that do come up in a journey, right? You can't always have a 100% positive, response of sorts. You just own it, you know, from your heart and tell them that, okay, this is what it is. You talk to the consumer. You don't leave it unaddressed. You do respond to them. You tell them because that's what they want. They have bought into your brand philosophy. They've brought into your product, right? And you can't leave them unattended. It's very important to be honest. And that's what we follow at Xiaomi very closely. There are also times where there's an expectation mismatch. And the brand is not wrong. There is a certain expectation that the consumer has, which is not something that is an industry requirement per se, hypothetically. In which case, you do give an explanation. You again don't stand tall as a brand and back off from the discussion. You always talk to your consumer. You listen to them. You respond to them. You tell them we're here for you. We need to be very, modest as a brand. We can't be a brand that doesn't, take into the consumer's needs or requirements. We need to explain. It's a necessity.
So given the fact that you're building the brand every moment, every day, with every interaction that's happening across multiple, platforms, it's not that one campaign that we do, the media campaign that we do, but it's a campaign that's 24/7 on in a way, right? That's the life we are living now. Bharat, are you seeing a trend where companies are using automated tools and machine learning, etc., to kind of be always on and to manage this? Because it is a tough one to manage, to be always be available all the time and do the right thing every time.
Absolutely. In fact, I'll give you one live example. I landed in Bangladesh and I was just passing through customs. and I just checked into Facebook and I got a call from a telecom player, you know, to buy a SIM card. You know, so it's so real time out there. You know, so I'm like fully excited to say that big data, artificial intelligence and robotics is what the brands are looking for in the next 1 year.
That's a big statement.
Yeah.
Robotics as well.
Yeah.
Cool. So, three, four things that come to my mind, and I want to kind of do a sign-off note from each of you. One thing that came up clearly is that the millennial consumer is looking to be a part of our brands and not necessarily be spoken to, but I would like to have a conversation. I think that's something which is very clearly coming out from all our experiences. The second one that's coming out is that the peer group and the people whom I'm influenced by as a consumer are very important for me. My decisions get driven by that, like you spoke about, Somashri, that I would have already done my search even before I, you know, checked out the product. I'd already spoken to probably a few people before I even came and tried it out. So that, and I can do it real time. I don't need to spend time doing it. So that's very important, that group of people whom I'm connected to, and their views and opinions is very important. So I'm not just talking to an individual, I'm talking to a larger group. That seems to be a clear trend that's emerging. And finally, Naresh, what you kind of spoke about, that the service delivery and communication in some sense needs to get integrated, and it's the same thing. It can't be that communication is independent of service delivery. Both are integrated with each other, and so in a way the business logistics and the communication logistics will need to probably come together to be able to address this consumer. These are the three, four things that key takeaways that, you know, I'm getting. Any observations you have, given that you also have a bird's eye view, you work with multiple brands, and you also work with, you have an understanding of consumers as well?
Well, in regards with millennials, if I talk about, I can only say that we sit on almost 70% of the, you know, millennials, which is my audience as of now. And as Bharat said, you know, the robotics and the artificial intelligence and the machine learning, which is coming up. Well, I'm sorry, Bharat, but I somewhat disagree on that. Why? Because as we discussed earlier as well, there is a very thin line between, you know, going ahead and, you know, helping a consumer and then going ahead and making him irritated as to by throwing him the same ads again and again. In regards with understanding, coming to your question, in regards with understanding the user behavior, yes, we do have our own machine learning platform, we do have our own DMPs which we work on, and we understand what kind of content a consumer on UC is coming and consuming. We are able to understand what kind of behavior they have, we are able to understand what kind of age group they come from. For example, I'll give you an example. There was a certain brief from one of the big FMCG companies which came to us, and which was like, they wanted to target only mothers. Now, how would you target mothers? Right. So you can actually target mothers or people or ladies who are expecting by just understanding the kind of behavior they are using on a browser or the kind of content they are using. The data becomes small, but that becomes more than 90% precise. So that's how we generally go ahead and do that.
Rahul, amongst the many set of services that are a part of the Urban Cloud portfolio, they are the top three, right? What are those and why are they top three amongst consumers? And typically, what's the kind of age group which takes on to these top three services that you have?
So Urban Cloud as a platform appeals more to folks in a certain life stage and beyond, which is 25 plus. I think our core TG is working women. It's 25 plus. So the top three services in Urban Clap are beauty at home, which is a high repeat category, super high play on convenience and excellence of service delivery. Second biggest service is appliance repairs, because the current offline alternatives are just twofold. Either you call an OEM and wait for them to show up. I mean, it's generally a broken experience. I don't want to generalize it. And the second option is you go to a nearby market and you find a guy. So appliance repairs as a category has really, really picked up for us. And the third emerging large category for Urban Clap is actually massages and spa at home. Again, the consumer of today needs these services, like a stress relief service or a simple pain relief service at home. And we realized how massively this is exploding in the top three markets. So actually, I want to connect that to the whole millennial piece and build a little on what Naresh said about and Karan said about authenticity, delivering what you promise, right? I think there's one more large aspect, very important aspect, which appeals to millennials, which is a multi-channel marketing strategy. Digital actually has been generalized too far. I think digital is also very, very nuanced. Indian consumers are coming online for the first time in their lives on their mobile phones, unlike the West, where the laptop or the computer or a desktop was the first port of call to go online. So on that screen, which is a 4x5 screen, there are still multiple channels of communication. And a lot of authenticity and brand loyalty or brand promise can be communicated through multiple channels. And being on multiple channels really appeals to a large variety of consumers, because then they start believing in the brand promise, depending on, of course, your messaging and depending on the real product delivery. So yeah, these are the two points. I think I've answered your question about the top three services and
absolutely.
Also.
And what's interesting is there's always been the fear about letting someone in to your home, right? And in all the services that you provide and the top three services that you provide, except for probably the appliance thing where you're used to someone coming to your home, the other two, traditionally you've not been used to people coming home and servicing you. It's interesting how you broke that barrier.
Actually, it was important for us to identify that there is a need in the market, right? The multitasker woman of today doesn't really have time. She's juggling so many things, from work to the home to the kids. There is just so much to juggle, right? So we realized there is a paucity of time that's a problem in her life, and also a promise of quality. When we combined those two, it was seeming like a very obvious answer. Of course, exactly. I mean, Ashwin, the fact you mentioned about the possibility of things going wrong, right, they are immense, because right from someone entering your home, your personal space, inside your home, they are seeing how many kids you have, what time you're coming back, going in, etc., etc. So yes, all of those different points of interaction have to be managed extremely carefully. But yes, I think the eureka moment for us was when the first consumer said that, yeah, this is something I would take, and then we'll build from there.
Brilliant. So a point that clearly came out from this conversation that you had was this consumer is clearly consuming content and communication across multiple channels at the same time. So it's a multi-channel, omni-channel kind of a consumption of content that's happening at the same time. And you need to be there everywhere. The other thing obviously is that attention span is also low. So how can our communication fit into that attention span, make it interesting for them? And a little what we spoke about earlier in terms of talking to the peers and talking relevant and having relevant conversations. Like you spoke about creating a product and the service which was needed, right? So if it's relevant, I'm short of time, can you make my life easier? And can you communicate that to me quickly? I would probably listen to you and start connecting with you as a brand. Is the right thing to say?
Yeah.
Cool. Any Naresh, you have something to add now?
So yeah, I think on the whole co-creation piece, I think just tying it back to, I also just see this whole thing as a huge opportunity. I just believe that word of mouth as a channel of marketing has just been amplified. Like while we talk about, you know, things, negative things traveling very fast or, what the pitfalls of social media, which generally tends to be the theme for marketers, I also believe this is just a huge opportunity to even amplify good things, for people to back you as a brand. So there have been many moments, even in CureFit and in my past history in Myntra, where when things have gone wrong, there have been hordes of your loyal customers that have actually come and backed you. And in an industry like us, a lot of things can go wrong. You can get into trouble with some local authorities, you can get into trouble with a politician or his son, all kinds of things can happen when you're geographically distributed like this. But social media and the mindset of the millennial today just also gives you that opportunity as a marketer to have, you know, your back is covered by your loyal guys who you've done right by. So I think that's the only thing I would add, and I would think that that's very common with Urban Clap as well, that working woman who you're saving time for every week ultimately becomes a champion for your brand, and that's a huge asset to have in this age.
Great. So it's not a formula which can't be broken, clearly. But I think we'll need to change the way we are probably thinking about a consumer. We will need to be available for the consumer real time, always. We need to co-create not just our communication, but our product as well with them, and listen to them, like you said. And more importantly, be sensitive to their likes, dislikes, and their larger group of people that they work with and live with as we interact with them. And I think we should be able to figure out, with the help of some machine learning, how to be able to connect it to them on a real-time basis every day. Cool. Thank you so much for your time and insights on how you've been running your brands. And I hope it was entertaining as well. That was the brief that Anurag gave me, saying that if you don't entertain, I'll kill you. But so thank you so much for being patient listeners, and all the best for the evening.
Check. Well, thank you. Thank you so much. Could I request everyone to come close together for a picture and be on stage, yes, for a moment. We want everyone in the picture, so irrespective of left, right, or center, everyone. And we would also like to present a token of gratitude to all of you, and I would like to call on stage Mr. Prakash S., Head Business Development from Wickerton Group, to please present the token of gratitude to all our panelists, and Mr. Padmanabhan over here. Welcome, sir. Well, some of the takeaways from this discussion which I managed to get were like, millennials are all about creating experiences, and even if you do a mistake as a brand, you should own that mistake, and it's absolutely okay to apologize. If they are their two true loyal consumers, they will back you up no matter what. Alright, can we please have once again a huge round of applause for all the panelists over here and our session chair. Ma'am, can we have one photo? Sorry for that. Thank you so much. Thank you so much once again.